Tagore invited Chinese, Japanese artists to come to India and stay with him in Shantiniketan outside of Calcutta. And it was an extraordinary moment. This is led into the 30s. And then Hussein also picked up on the idea to go to travel to China. And he went to see all that, he saw the tombs, the tongue horses, you will maybe know, those pottery horses. And it inspired him also to paint horses in a particular style. Actually, they relate to that Chinese 8th century pottery work, actually. Hussein is an incredible master of the line. He was a billboard painter. So he learned at nighttime, he told me he would roll out when the traffic subsided under the street light, rolled out a huge canvas on the floor to paint the billboard. So he had to paint fast before the traffic comes again. So he learned to have an extraordinary security of line, which you sense here. He's very abstract. He's thinking of the colors of Madhya Pradesh, where he grew up. He's these sort of earthy tones. Many paintings he called La Terre, the earth. And this one he's called Evasion, evasion of some kind. But you see all of the sort of elements are crystallizing. He will progress from here towards the Bindu paintings, incorporating tantric concepts and ideas where the sort of the shapes gradually crystallize and get a very clear structure. But these works leading towards there are actually very interesting, where you see how it's gelling and coming together and will sort of then form something more rigid.
He went a bit straight from Tantra, he went a bit philosophical there.
Yes, that's true.
That Tantra element was only in the beginning.
Yes.
So there were many series like Germination and everything, yes, which yes. Has nothing to do with.
Painted images of gods, and then he said, okay, he invited from Bavaria the lithographic printer specialist to come to India around 1890s or so to produce lithographs in India to multiply these images. So the so-called famous calendar prints, right? Everyone in India had images of gods framed on the wall, which were cheap to buy. But they're all going back to Ravi Varma.
So Hugo, is that true that actually Ravi Varma is credited to give one the face to our gods and goddesses, and also, you know, make it available to the poor?
Definitely, absolutely.
Right? Before that, it was only in the temples.
Yes.
Or it was sculptures which were more semi-precious metal that the poor could not ever afford.
That's true. You have in Calcutta, however, the sort of the Kaligat paintings.
That's right.
Where they painted cheap folk style paintings outside of the temple for people to have. Also, that goes back a little further. But Ravi Varma saw, I can formalize this, I can print multiples and make it really cheap. A few rupees everyone can afford. Mm. And that's true, that was a sort of democratization of that, and very intelligent, very clever. Manjit Baba is very quite unusual. He had his own sort of dreamlike visions and did these portraits, so to speak, against bold, flat color. He's a very unique, not inspired in any way by any Western influence, I would argue, uniquely his own style. It's a dreamlike quality and the power of art, and there, in a sense, Warhol, you know, plays into that too. He used color overlaid to express something different of how we look at what he might have used a black and white photo to start. So there are different ways of expressing, getting something across.
He loved poetry, so he really used to love and he used to sing. I remember back in the day he used to sing and then he used to paint. He had no commercial aspect to his works. In fact, most of these works were all bought from auction, and these particular two was bought from a very famous Swiss collector back in the 80s. So they're totally unseen and now they've come back to market. And this particular one is a portrait of Inapuri.
B. Prabha was very popular in the 60s. Also, Western collectors, when they came to India, she was the sort of thing they would buy. Absolutely. In those days, right? And Jamini Roy's, really.
Yeah.
So those were sort of stood as something typical Indian at the time. She painted the fisherwoman, sort of the scenes in the villages in an attractive and appealing way. And here we have Ara, which is a very nice and characteristic work for his. Flower still lives, he's excelled. He reminds me a bit in his style of the Italian artist De Pisis. With a very dry sort of, also did things like that.
Also with Ara, actually he started, he did see very poor times and he used to make a little bit of money by washing cars and all, and with which he would actually buy his art material. And of course his claim to fame was much later in life. But then of course other progressives like he's showing is Souza Hussain, and the most prominent artist group in India even today is considered progressive artist group, which was formed in 1947. And basically it had five members, which is Souza, Raza, Hussain, Gade and Ara. So these five of course are considered to be the founders of modern Indian art.
He connected with the literati scene in London just like that. He was a great writer as well. So they loved him in London for it. And he connected to, Francis Bacon even. They were buddies, drinking buddies in those days. And in some ways, Souza was ahead of Bacon in some of the devices, like the defining a space in the background, the sort of boxes. You see Souza doing it just a little bit ahead of Bacon. But they had an exchange. By 1959, Souza is really at the peak of his powers. He painted a fantastic crucifixion, which is now at the Tate, Britain. Because at that time, Souza became English citizen. And they look at him today as also a British painter. So the Tate had a whole gallery of 50s English painting, and they put one Souza there to represent England. That's quite wonderful. D1, maybe Connor, would you like to take it from here?
Yeah. Well, you told them, basically, Souza, obviously at the time, this is working at the height of his powers, as Hugo said, and it's got a very nice label on the back, and it's called From Gallery One, and they were the first gallery that showed him in London. And the title of the work is The Businessman. So it's kind of iconic. It's The Businessman. The businessman. So, and obviously, in that time in Britain, post-war, there was a lot of, angst and anxiety and questioning the institutions and questioning society, blah, blah, blah. And so Bacon is there. So Souza's doing his own sort of questioning and of society. And this is, again, so the questioning of capitalism perhaps coming through. And there's a quite scary businessman, isn't he? He's not, I'm not a happy man.
No.
So, yeah. So, and obviously, it's a particularly nice painting because this painting has not been seen since it was bought from Gallery One way back then in the 60s. It's been a private collection. It's the first time it's been seen ever.
Well, of course, you know this international celebrated artist called Olafur Eliasson. Olafur loves to play with light. Either light, just as light with multiple colors, or reflection. So as you sort of walk past this work, you will actually see the colors changing, and it's nothing but static sort of ball of glass.
He's wedged out the glass from the back and made, the center is silver wedge, the side is black, and the other side is yellow.
Yellow, so that's so, the reflection that you actually see. That's right. The background is colored in a way that you see it from just three angles. So as we walk past, you should actually see the change in the color. Let's walk this way. There's this artist, Yudhishthir Mahajan. He's a Nepalese American, sort of spends his time mostly in Nepal and in US. He picks up books from thrift stores, and it's just the paper which he has cut, strips, twisted, woven, and his work is just totally out of, there's no addition, there's no adhesive. Is there any adhesive that you sort of use? So it's just pure paper. His name is Kulu Ojha. He layers papers and then he carves, basically. So it looks like wood carving, but it's actually paper. And it's just totally carved out.
Thank you.
And it's again an aerial view of an imagined village with some kind of a palace or a fort. Exactly.
I started collecting the tissue papers from my trips to Europe while making artists in residency or exhibitions. While visiting the museum shops, I started collecting the tissue papers. And over the 7 or 8 years of period, I collected so many tissue papers. So I was thinking what to do with that.
Quite all this tissue paper.
Yes, and I realized they each one represent a different culture.
How interesting is that? And then you bring it all together and actually end up representing the Indian architecture and
Indian
sort of views.
Motifs from different cultures. Yeah, juxtaposing elements from different culture together. Fantastic.
This is a cockroach.
Yeah, I know.
And you know, I peek. The cockroach is very, you know, when I see, I feel really, you know, but I wanted to make it beautiful, you know, put the gold leaves and this species are from the say American species, you know, the different types of cockroaches. So this one particular American species. And you know the cockroach can survive.
Yeah.
Reference
you know,
in America.
On the top, it's from here it's a more abstract, but if you go up there, because it's a three-dimensional object, so if you see there, you can read, this is don't shoot.
Don't shoot. It's from this side.
Yeah, I can read it.
This is a work of Janathanan. He is a South Indian artist. He lives in South. He works in iron, which is rusted. And then he pretty much reacts to the yoga poses and sort of creates these sort of three-dimensional works. And this is also, you know, what sits a bit. But then his idea is purely sourced from the tradition of yoga and stretches and exercise.
Very beautiful.
This is, you know, B.B. Doshi,
yes.
The architect, and Dayanita. Dayanita Singh did a project. I mean, she does this project. I mean, her expression is through books. I mean, that's what she sort of does. So she went and shot projects of B.B. Doshi, and then this is called the B.B. Box. And it's an edition of 360 of these boxes. What you actually get is just one box with 30 prints?
30 prints.
With 30 prints, and you can change your print to what you see every day.
I see. You make your own of
your own sort of a thing every day. Exactly. She insists that you don't put it all out like this at all. She insists that it's actually done one at a time.
Yeah.